So let me start briefly again. So my name is Surendra, and I did my thesis at I did my BE Mechanical Engineering and minor in Physics at BITS Goa, KK Birla Goa campus. So yeah, I did do a master's in physics, and even then I got into a PhD program at Penn State, and we can talk about that, how I got into Penn State for PhD, etc., and for another time. And after my thesis at UW Madison, where I worked on particle astrophysics on cosmic ray accelerators like Blazar, I moved to Penn State and exent researcher, where I worked on computational astrophysics applied to binary black hole and binary neutron star mergers. And recently, I've been also part of ICTS Bangalore, where I've just recently started working on gravitational wave data analysis, mainly parameter estimation. So it's mainly gravitational wave astronomy, which I'll be talking about in this talk. So yeah, as Sitara pointed out, this is a more like a conversation, because this is just a lecture where I want you people to get to know me and my research interests, and I get to know you. So you can interrupt me during the talk. You can either post a question on the chat, or you can raise your hand if there is such an option, and then Sitara can unmute you or something, and you can ask a question. And I think with that, let's start. So yeah, so today the topic is going to be astrophysics of compact binaries. By compact objects, I mean objects like white dwarf, neutron stars, and black holes, which are nothing but the end products of a life cycle of a star. Like, as soon as the star undergoes continuous stellar evolution while it's in main sequence, it undergoes either a supernova, or there might be two stars which were initially in a binary, and they were revolving around each other, and they start closing in each other because of loss of energy through gravitational waves, and they combine and they form a remanent object. So there might be many other ways of producing these compact objects, like I'm talking about white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black holes. But yeah, so in my case, I'm talking about such a scenario where you have two compact objects in a binary orbit around each other, and they are closing in each other. And why are they closing in each other? Because they're losing their orbital energy in terms of gravitational waves. So whatever gravitational waves that are being released, they're taking away the energy from this orbital dynamics. Or you can also think of it in another way, that the gravitational waves is actually back reacting on these compact objects and pushing these two objects towards each other in that orbit. Okay, so these compact objects can be anything. You can either have a binary neutron star systems wherein you have both the neutron stars, both the compact objects as neutron stars, or both the objects as black holes, or both the objects as white dwarfs, or one object as black hole and the other object as white dwarf, one object as black hole, one object as neutron star. I mean, you can imagine. You can try out all the combinations. And one way to deal with while studying these compact objects, right? So when these compact objects are pretty far off, you can say when the distance or separation between them is almost more than 50 kilometers or so, you can actually use something called post-Newton approximation. Okay, where post-Newton approximation, you can actually treat these two compact objects as point particles. Okay, and when you're treating these point particles, you ignore the internal structure of these two particles. You only care the orbital dynamics of it, okay, and nothing else. And why we use post-Newton and all that, we can talk about some other time. But yeah, once the objects actually come close to each other and the separation becomes less than 50 kilometers, so remember, 50 kilometers is not an exact value, but it's a characteristic value. I mean, on an average. It may not be true in all the binaries, but on an average, when the two compact objects come near to each other on less than 50 kilometers, that's when the internal structure of the objects become important. And why is that? Because the gravity of both these compact objects become important. And since this gravity becoming so important, the gravity can actually affect now the internal structure of the object. By that, what I mean, it can either change the radius of the object, it can slightly deform the shape of the object, and by changing this radius and shape of the object, it can actually alter the orbital dynamics. And through altering this orbital dynamics, you see a change in the gravitational signal that you receive. I mean, I'm hoping that you know what a gravitational signal is. A gravitational signal is nothing but it's a ripple in space-time, which is caused due to some objects revolving each other. Like any object that revolves around each other, like any system that has two objects which are revolving around each other, can actually produce a gravitational signal. But for it to be strong and for the detectors on Earth to detect those gravitational waves, the objects need to have very strong gravity. And the only place where you can get this strong gravity is when you have compact objects, okay? And before this 50 kilometers, I was saying, you can try to get the gravitational wave form that you want to detect using your detector, like LIGO, Kagra, etc., that new upcoming detector, etc., a Virgo in Italy, using some analytical calculations. Like you can get how the gravitational wave is going to vary, the frequency and the amplitude of it is going to vary with time. You can get that analytically on pen and paper. But it turns out when the objects are near to each other, less than 50 kilometers, the gravity becomes so strong and the equations, right? Like how do you get this gravitational signal? By solving some equation, right? It turns out when the objects are far apart, the equations are simple and can be solved and you can find an analytical solution. But when the objects are below 50 kilometers, the equations become non-linear and also partially differentiated, meaning you have a set of non-linear partial differential equation. And what are those equations exactly? We'll come to that later. But yeah, so we have a set of partial non-linear partial differential equation which we need to solve so that we can get the dynamics of the system. By dynamics, I mean, how do these stars revolve around each other? How does their orbit decay? How does the bodies get deformed? What is the gravitational signal that is produced? Or any other interesting astrophysical phenomenon that is happening out there? So to get all this information out of that system, you need to solve this set of non-linear partial differential equations. But turns out, unfortunately, our mathematics cannot allow us to do that. We don't have any methods to solve and get an exact analytical solution for a given nonlinear partial differential equation. If someone can come up, obviously they'll get a Nobel Prize because that's how tough it is, and it has been so many centuries and nobody has found a way to get an exact or a good enough solution for a nonlinear partial differential equation. So then how do we go about it? We cannot stop science, right? Since we just so that we can't get an analytical solution. So we have to approach this problem some other way. That's wherein computational science steps in. And you people should remember, computational science doesn't mean doing something on computers and that's not at all related to physics. No, you're mistaken. It's completely pure physics, and I would say it's theoretical physics. And in the modern day, there are two ways of doing theoretical physics, either analytical on paper with pen or on a computer using computational methods. So these are the two broad ways of dealing with theoretical physics. So even computational astrophysics comes under theoretical astrophysics. And I would say sometimes computational astrophysics is very difficult because you need to have so many multidisciplinary skills, which I'll be talking about in this talk later, like what skills one needs to develop, etc. But yeah, so we need to code up our equations, our non-linear partial differential equations on a computer. And that is why we need computational astrophysics. Why? Because we can't get an exact analytical or good enough approximate analytical solution for our given non-linear partial differential equation. So to get high accurate answers for our problems at hand, one can only use computational astrophysics. Only then can you actually get answers for a few systems where the equations are non-linear in nature and partial differential equations in nature. And what is computational astrophysics? It's nothing but discretizing this set of equations on a grid. So I can give you an example which I used to explain to my brother as to what I do on a daily basis. So maybe a simple example, like suppose you take a bed, okay, and you're sleeping on the bed. And one company comes to you, comes to a computational scientist or a modeling, numerical modeling person and says, I need to create a bed which is really good, which is very comfortable for anyone who sleeps on it. So what all factors do you want to consider in, right, while creating a bed which is very comfortable? So there are some list of factors you can say. But how do you model this? The way you model is you take the bed and you discretize the bed in terms of some cells. Like you have some grid points, okay, and you're sleeping on the bed. And when you're sleeping on the bed, the first approximation to do is treat you as a spherical body. And you're saying, due to the spherical body, this is the deformation that I get in this bed. If I take the bed to have uniform density and made up of some sort of material, okay? And similarly, I assume that the person who is sleeping on this bed has a uniform density and has some material in it, so that I can get the mass and what is the stress at a point, given point, what is the strain at the given point, and I can see how is this material reacting under this stress, and I remove the weight and I see how is it going back to its original position, the relaxation, how is the relaxation. All this relaxation and the response to this stress is dependent on properties of the bed and the properties of the weight that's on the bed, right? So this is a very crude way of doing things, but you want to go to the next step. Let's say I don't want to take the human as a spherical body, but let's say he has some structure. So now you want to capture how each of his body applies a stress on the bed. And now, you know, at first I said, discretize the whole bed into uniform grid, right? But now it doesn't make sense to discretize the whole bed into uniform, because a human cannot occupy the whole bed if it's a huge bed, obviously. So there's a lot of empty space where there is no stress at all, or where the stress due to the human can actually be neglected. So you can increase the size of the discretization at those areas where there is no human body, and increase the resolution of your grid where the human body is actually present. So this is called adaptive mesh refinement, just to give you a term out there. And now you can capture the response of the bed and the relaxation of the bed more accurately, right? And the next thing would come, so you want to do this on different kinds of beds, like beds made of different materials, humans of different structures, of different weights, etc. So you have so many test cases that you have to do. So if you consider one bed, one type of human, and you consider another bed A, bed B, bed C, human A, human B, human C, and you see how each of them respond, you combine all of them and you give out your output. Turns out, when you're actually trying to do this and you're trying to discretize the whole bed, etc., and all this, the equations that you have, right, which actually defines how much stress the human is applying, how much strain the bed is undergoing, which depends on the properties of the bed and the human. So they become more and more complicated, and they need more and more computations per se, because you're increasing the number of points, right, that you're considering in order to get the answer for your solution. Okay, I hope I was clear there. So what I'm trying to say is that the complexity of the problem keeps on increasing, and also the number of equations that you have to solve, or the number of number of iterations that you have to solve, the number of grid points that you have to solve for this equation on keeps on increasing as you increase the complexity of the problem. So this is how you do, like this is what we do in computational astrophysics, like we discretize the given set of equations, and what are these equations have? These equations have the properties of the system and the properties of the source, whatever that's sourcing something, okay? And in a binary black hole system or a binary neutron star system, you just have a computational setup which fills up this entire space where these two neutron stars or two compact objects sit, and you discretize the compact objects, and you write in some equations which actually describe what these compact objects are and how they interact, and you solve for the solution. And as you increase the complexity, the number of equations that you have to solve also keep increasing drastically. And after a certain time, you cannot do it on a pen and a paper. You have to use a computer. And sometimes it turns out you cannot even use a laptop. You have to use a supercomputer. And that's how computational astrophysics is done, which is my next question. How is it done? It's usually done on a laptop or a big supercomputer wherein you have a lot of CPUs and GPUs interconnected, and you parallelize your problem. Say, I'll divide the problem into two and I give one part of the problem to one CPU and the other problem or the problem to another CPU, etc. So you do all this parallelization, etc., which we'll come to in the future lectures. But yeah, that's how computational astrophysics is done. And if you want accurate answers, you need to increase the resolution of your grid. But one cannot keep on increasing the resolution and take it to infinity, because there is also something else, which is computational resources. So if you keep on increasing the resolution, the number of equations increase, right? And you just can't solve infinitely many number of equations on a limited computational resource, which has limited memory power, limited disk space. So you have to sometimes adjust, and you can't go beyond a certain resolution, because if you go beyond that resolution, the problem becomes so complicated and so computationally expensive that you cannot solve it on a supercomputer also. So you have to take a midway between, not too low resolution, but not too high resolution, something in between, which can actually give you a good answer, which can be used later in the observations and detect these objects, right? So that's how it is. And yeah, many a times it also helps analytical calculations. As I was saying, if you take any problem in physics, all the equations are non-linear partial differential equation. And whatever equations that you have come across during your undergrad or grad or whatever physics that you did are always simple ordinary differential equations, which can be solved on pen and paper. But if you really want to get the real dynamics of the system and the more accurate answer, you need to use computational astrophysics or computational physics for that matter. And sometimes you might get some new results that you have not seen during your analytical calculations. So it can guide the analytical calculations people on how to proceed further. So that also happens. And yeah, so while I was talking about computational astrophysics, there are many ways of doing it. Like there are different systems, right? Ranging from a binary white dwarf system, or it can be a core collapse supernova. It can be some star formation, like stars forming in a dense cloud of gas, or it can be some large scale structure that you're studying. So there are a variety of computational problems that you have to deal with. But in my specific case, I talk about compact binaries, right? In that case, we use two things called numerical relativity, which is this, and GRMHT. I'll come to what they mean. So numerical relativity is nothing but, so as you know, after 1915, we no longer think that Newtonian gravity is accurate. What's more accurate than Newtonian gravity is actually Einstein field equations, which actually tell us how does the gravity bend when you have a mass around it. Like how does the mass and energy curve the space-time, and then how does the space-time tell the mass to move in that curved space-time. That's what basically Einstein field equations is. You're capturing what gravity is in terms of geometry of the space-time, and what part of the geometry of space-time? The curvature of the space-time. That's all for Einstein field equations. We'll go into deep more later, but yeah. Once you have these Einstein field equations, it turns out, even in this case, if you want to get an exact solution, one can only approximate or take some assumptions or some symmetries in your system. Take, say, you take a spherical symmetry for your system, that your system is homogeneous or some isotropic, some assumptions like that. And you convert these complicated Einstein field equations into simple ordinary differential equations again, which were previously non-linear partial differential equation, but once you take these assumptions and etc., they boil down to an ordinary differential equation setup and you solve them. But turns out, you can only do that when your gravity is not very strong or when your particles are not moving very fast. But when the gravity is very strong or when the particles are moving very fast, you cannot take these assumptions or symmetries. One has to solve the full non-linear partial differential equations of Einstein field equations. And the only way we can do it, as I said previously, is by coding up these equations on a computer. And that's where numerical relativity comes in. Numerical relativity is nothing but solving your Einstein field equations without any assumptions, like that the objects are slowly moving or the objects under study have a slow gravity. Obviously, in compact object binaries, you cannot take that approximation because compact objects have a very, very high self-gravity. As you may know, black hole has a very high self-gravity, neutron star has a very high self-gravity, and white dwarf also has compared to your regular stars or rockets, etc. So you need to capture those strong dynamics. And the only way to do is to solve the full nonlinear differential equation, which is Einstein field equations. And the way you do it is using numerical relativity. And as you also may have heard, numerical relativity is actually Einstein field equations are actually four-dimensional equations, wherein the time and space are interconnected with each other. But turns out, one can discretize these four-dimensional equations and solve for the solution. When you have two compact binaries and you want to look at all the astrophysical phenomena that happen, turns out it's not a good idea. The solution is not stable that you get out of this, like when you apply a particular numerical method to solve these coded up equations, discretized equations on a computer. The one best way to do is the good old way, which is called 3+1 decomposition or initial value problem. And what do I mean by initial value problem? To give a simple example, supposing you take an object and it has a certain angle, right? And you throw it at a certain angle. And now you want to estimate the trajectory of that particle, right? It takes a curve like this. It takes up a curve like this. And you want to know what height it goes, how much radius it goes and all that. So these two depend on what? On the initial angle that it makes with the horizontal axis x, and then what is the velocity of it, right? Based on that, you can get the kinematics of this particle and say, yeah, you have a gravity too, which is acting downwards. And you put in all these equations and you get the resultant thing. What is the resultant thing? The path that this particle takes. And what does it depend upon? The gravity, the velocity, and the position of the particle, and the angle with respect to the x-axis, right? Similarly, so this is what initial value problem is. Like you provide an initial condition for this particle that the gravity is this, that the velocity of the particle initially at t is equal to zero is this, some v, and the theta is some theta naught, right? T is equal to some t naught, if you may. And you use the equations that you have, which are nothing but Newton's laws of motion and Newton's law of gravity, right? And you can use those both and get the trajectory of this particle starting from these initial conditions. Similarly, even when you're dealing with Einstein field equations, when you do this 3+1 decomposition, what you're basically doing is you're deconstructing the four-dimensional space-time into 1D space-time and a 3D space. It means the 3D space evolves from one time to the other. And there's more complicated story as to how we can decompose these and whether we can decompose these. Does it even make sense to decompose and all that? But yeah, this is what we do basically. We decompose the four-dimensional space-time into a one-dimensional time and if a three-dimensional space. And pictorially, the way it looks is this. Like you take a chunk, which is a four-dimension. I mean, since in a 3D, I can only draw a 3D diagram here. I cannot draw a 4D, right? Because we're three-dimensional beings. We cannot draw four-dimensional drawings. To picture, what we're going to do is, we're going to take a time curve along which the time is, and we're going to take some surfaces which is normal to this time curve. And this slice is nothing but x and y. And z, you can imagine a three-dimensional thing. I cannot draw on this, so, and that is why I'm not drawing. So as the time progresses, the quantities that they leave on this sheet gets translated to the next sheet. And from here, they go to the next sheet. This is nothing but it's similar to going from one point to the another point in space-time, where this point is given by t, x, y, 1, t1, and this point is given by t2, x2, and y2. So a translation, but yeah, from going from here to here, this is called some word line. So this can be represented in this way. Okay, so you're decomposing the space and time into two different things, and you're going from one space slice to the next space slice. And how do we do this decomposition and all that, we'll come into that future lectures. But yeah, this is what we basically do. So we start off with some initial data, which lives on this initial slice of space. And from there, you use some evolving equations to evolve this initial data to the next slices. Okay, and this is how you get the dynamics of your system from one point in time to the next point in time. And to solve these equations, evolving equations, and to get this initial data, one has to use numerical relativity. And that's where what I said, setup. It's called initial data, evolving equations. And how do you do this initial data and evolving equations? You use some numerical methods. And there are a lot of numerical methods which you may have heard, some like Newton-Raphson method, Runge-Kutta-Fohr method, something like that, like which each method does something. But yeah, there are some numerical methods. And once you discretize these equations and employ these numerics, and you put all this setup on a HPC, you get out a solution. And you plot it using some Python or something like that. And some examples of this numerical relativity are gravitational collapse. Like suppose we have a star which has immense gravity, and there is no longer any nuclear fusion happening in it, and the star starts collapsing and it forms a black hole maybe. And how does this happen? Like how does the horizon dynamics occur? Like how does the horizon start forming around your center of the star? Does it start at the center and grow towards the surface, or does the horizon start at the surface and go towards the center? How does it happen? That's called horizon dynamics, and that's what's done in gravitational collapse. And the other is compact binaries. And interestingly, even there are some equations in quantum gravity itself, which you may have heard, a very hi-fi term called quantum gravity. Even there, sometimes the equations turn out to be really complicated to solve on with a pen and paper. And even then you use computational techniques to solve the quantum gravity equations. And the other is formation of singularities, Kerr black hole. It turns out if one really wants to know what are the if you take a test particle, by test particle I mean a particle which has a very less mass and it's going around a Kerr black hole, and you want to understand what is the exact orbit that the test particle is going to take around this Kerr black hole, you cannot do it analytically sometimes, and that's when you have to use computational techniques again, and a lot of interesting numerical relativity which will come later. But yeah, some open source famous numerical relativity software that anybody can check out, the slides will be shared later obviously, those are Einstein Toolkit, GR Combo, and if someone's into Python and they only know Python and they don't know C++, C, Fortran, etc., they can look up NRPyPlus. And I'm strongly suggesting it's a very good way to go if you're a beginner and if you're interested in dealing with numerical relativity and dealing with all these different applications. If you find this interesting, I would strongly say go to this website, go through the tutorials and etc. So I also made a note here. Yeah. And till now, whenever I said numerical relativity and all these computational techniques, I only spoke about gravity, right? But I never spoke about magnetic field. But I never seriously spoke about matter. Like when you actually take two black holes, they are nothing but space-time, right? They don't have any matter in them. They are just vacuums. They are just vacuum which has some space-time structure and are revolving around each other. But when you take two neutron stars, they do have some matter inside them. And they have some rotation. And they do have some magnetic field. So this rotation, the presence of matter, the presence of magnetic field actually complicates your system dynamics. And one needs to consider even this when trying to model your system. So some relevant physical situations where this GRMHC, which is nothing but general relativistic magneto-hydrodynamics. Sorry for my bad handwriting. So where hydrodynamics is nothing but the matter part, where everything is treated as a fluid. Magneto is nothing but your B field or your E field. Turns out in these compact objects, E field is almost zero most of the times. There is no electric field. It's only the magnetic field which is very important. And whereas general relativistic is nothing but it means the gravity is very strong and that one has to use Einstein field equations to solve for the gravity. Like as you know, the Einstein field equations is given as right? I can remove this, maybe cause confusions. Yeah. It's given as this. Where this is the matter part, which sources the gravity, and this is the geometry part, which tells how your space-time is curved. Okay? And whenever you don't have any matter part, this becomes zero. And you're only solving this. You're solving basically this equation. This equation may look simple, but is very complicated. I'll come later what this equation means, but later in future lectures. But when there is matter, you need to consider the contributions due to the fluid. There is someone's trying to speak. Okay, and there is this magnetic field that you need to consider into this. This is called stress energy tensor, stress energy momentum tensor. We'll come to what a tensor is, etc. If you don't know later. So this is a stress energy momentum tensor which takes in the amount of magnetic field present, the amount of fluid that's present. By fluid, I mean the density, the velocity of the particles that are present in your system, and say what type of gravity does it source through this equation, Yeah, even in this case, you need an initial data, evolving equations, some numerics and HPC. And some examples where GRMH is actually important is compact binaries, like binary neutron star, binary white dwarfs, or core collapse supernova, or a neutron star, white dwarf merger, etc. And they're also important in jets. Like, as you know, when you have a huge magnetic field, right, around a rotating compact object, sometimes it may happen that a jet may be launched along the axis or slightly off the axis of the spin axis of the object. And to treat this jet, one has to use at least an MHD equation. Like in jets, the gravity may not be so strong, and one can actually use something called Newtonian MHD. Because the gravity is not strong. I mean, basically the takeaway from this is whenever the gravity is strong, one needs to consider Einstein equations. And whenever the gravity is small, you need to consider Newtonian gravity. And the other one example of application of GRMHD is accretion disks. Like when you have an accretion disk that is getting accreted onto a black hole or a neutron star, and you want to understand what is happening in that accretion disk. What type of electromagnetic wave does it release? An X-ray or gamma ray burst or soft X-rays or a UV? What is the spectrum that you get out of that accretion disk? So to model all that, one needs to use MHC. And the other is star formation. Like supposing you take a bunch of gas. There is this famous criteria called Jeans criteria. Like supposing the density in your initial cloud of gas goes beyond a certain point, more and more gets matter collapse to that point because of gravitational instability, and the object starts forming a star. But exactly how many stars will form, where will the stars form in the given initial cloud, and to understand that, one has to use magnetohydrodynamics. And one more famous example which you all may have heard is called Event Horizon Telescope. Right, wherein you're actually looking at the ray tracing around black holes. Like whenever you have this accretion disk, right, and they're not calm, they're not peaceful, they release a lot of X-rays, radio waves, etc. And whenever this electromagnetic radiation is actually released, they undergo a circular orbit or some hyperbolic or parabolic orbit around the black hole, and they reach Earth. To understand what is the exact orbital dynamics of these photons are nothing but electromagnetic radiation, right? Yeah, how these photons travel around the black hole and what type of image do they make, what type of shadow do they make, even there, general relativistic magnetohydrodynamics is important. And if there are any beginners and who is interested in dealing with this, they have to look at the software called Clawpack, which is a basic thing. And the other is, which I personally use, it's called WhiskyTHC, but it's a way more complicated code compared to Clawpack. But if there are some beginners, they should look at this following links, where Ian Hawke is a professor at University of Southampton and specializes a lot and has given, I've made a very nice set of lecture notes and tutorials and exercises on GRMHD and numerical hydrodynamics. And this is called Open Astrophysics Bookshelf, which has a set of books which teaches you astrophysics starting from fundamentals. And this is just my website where I compile few resources, a Bitbucket base. You can go through that too. So I put a break here. Supposing if someone has some questions, we can go through them.
Yeah, maybe you could look at the chat. Actually, while you were talking, Vivek had asked, I'm sorry, could you repeat what you said about the need for 3+1 decomposition?
Yeah, so the need for 3+1 decomposition is that, see, you can either discretize these four-dimensional equations. I'm writing it here. So these are actually four-dimensional equations, okay? So it turns out that whenever you discretize these four-dimensional equations and you try to apply some numerics on it and put it on a supercomputer, and when you look at the solution, supposing a solution should have looked like this, okay? Like supposing you know a particular system, okay, and how it behaves, and you want the system to vary smoothly. But it turns out whenever you don't have a good numerical solution, or when your solution doesn't converge to a particular value, when you increase the resolution, like as you increase the resolution more and more, the solution should converge. But it happens so that whenever you try to discretize these four-dimensional equations and you look at the stability of the solution and the convergence of the solution, it's very bad. Like sometimes it spikes up or it oscillates a lot, or you get more structures on the top of this smooth solution and you don't want all this. These are all called numerical noises, and they come because your solution is not stable and not convergent. Turns out when you have a 3+1 decomposition, one actually has good numerical techniques to deal with 3+1 decomposed problems and get a stable and a more converse solution. And you can go to high resolutions too without breaking up the stability. I don't understand what you mean by event horizon dynamics as such. No, sorry, let's not go into that. I mean, maybe Jaspreet, whatever question you asked, can the space-time fabric alter the properties of the particles too? Yes and no. I mean, we don't really know. That's all I can say. But yeah, one, that's where quantum gravity comes into picture. When the scales of your problem are so small and that you have to consider gravity. And yeah, I don't want to comment more on that. But if you are interested, you can always ping me up personally and we can talk later. Oh, evolution of the horizon. Okay, yeah. So what actually happens is when you have a regular star, right? And it starts collapsing. And people, please, this is just a pictorial representation. This is not how exactly it happens. Just to give you an analogy. So when the star is actually starts collapsing, sometimes it happens so that the horizon, so the same thing here, the horizon, when this matter is actually collapsing, the horizon starts from here, from the center, and grows in size, and then envelopes the whole matter and forms a black hole. And most people prefer this because this way you're actually covering up your singularity, which actually forms at the center. But there's another way of looking at horizon dynamics, wherein you actually, I got confused, but yeah. Okay, one way of looking at it is the horizon forms at the top, okay, and covering up the singularity. And the other way of looking at it is the singularity forms at the center, but then slowly, slowly, the horizon starts growing and then envelopes this singularity. So what I'm trying to say is that one wants to know how does this horizon change with respect to time? Like, does it grow or does it shrink, or does it start from surface and go to the center, or when does the singularity form? Does it form before the horizon forms? Does it form after the horizon forms? So all that is still unknown because we don't really understand how gravitational collapse exactly happens. To be frank, we don't exactly understand how a black hole forms, starting from a given initial condition. Yeah, that's how black holes lose energy because they have a negative orbit, meaning whenever you're on orbit around the black hole in that particular region of area, which is between the event horizon and the ergosphere, you can actually see in terms of the equations that the energies, rather than being transported to the black hole, it gets sucked by the particle, and it keeps on increasing its velocity. Okay, I think I'll answer these questions later. Okay, that's one more. These are really, I mean, what you people are asking are really good questions. But so one doesn't really know how a supermassive black hole forms, but people do think that in the initial universe, there might have been some fluctuations in the primordial soup of gas, and then some density fluctuation might have caused some of the matter to collapse into a black hole, and that black hole might have actually increased in its size and then went on to become a supermassive black hole. But this is still a very, very, very active research area as to how a supermassive black hole forms and grows. Like, how does that black hole form and grow to be the current supermassive black holes that we observe at the center of our galaxies? And one strong or way that people propose is they might have formed primordially, and later on, when two galaxies merge, these two black holes might merge and give rise to a more massive black hole. So that is all. And one can actually test these theories and see if supermassive black holes can actually form this way, like two galaxy merges, using something called LISA, laser interferometer space antenna, which is actually going to be up in the space in 10 to 20 years, which can actually detect these supermassive black hole binaries revolving around each other and merging. And maybe we can actually observe two galaxies merging. So that will be a smoking signal that that's how supermassive black holes are actually formed. Okay, any more questions I'll take later. Next, we move on to the topics of current. Maybe I'm going a bit slow. I need to speed it up. So the next thing is topics of current interest, where I'm actually talking about the different things that happen in correspondence to compact binaries. One is gravitational waves. They produce gravitational waves. They might produce fast radio bursts, short gamma ray bursts, accretion disks, and kilonova and tidal disruption events. We'll come to each and every later in more detail. And we can also see supernova. And by population models, what I actually mean is when you have these compact objects, right? Like, I say you take two compact objects which are revolving around each other, but how did they come about like that? Like, how did they start from two regular stars and end up a compact binary system, right? One needs to understand what is the evolution history of when you start with two regular stars and end up with two compact objects. Like, how does it happen? That's explained using population models. And one also wants to know, like, supposing you look around the galaxy using telescopes, you have different chemicals spread over the galaxy, right? Like, ranging from hydrogen, helium, silicon, carbon, oxygen, neon, or silicon, iron, or more lanthanides, actinides, which are the different elements in the periodic table. Like, how did they come out to be? Why is the distribution of those elements in that way? and that is studied using galactic chemical evolution, wherein you actually understand how do these chemicals are actually produced and how do they evolve. And turns out one of the prime candidate where elements which are greater than iron in terms of atomic number and mass number can actually form in binary neutron star mergers. And some may form in core collapse supernova. So these are two prime sources which can actually produce heavy elements. Okay, and these heavy elements are what populated in a galaxy, and this is what studied in galactic chemical evolution. And as I said, there are also some problems which are not under cannot be done analytically. So sometimes you take the problems of mathematical relativity and employ it in numerical relativity. And I also said there is large scale structure, and one wants to understand whether the universe started from a big bang or whether it goes under a cyclic thing. So it turns out when you want to study this period of expansion and contraction of a universe, one actually has to use again supercomputers, because the equations become non-linear and partial differential equations. So as I said here, you can study the large scale structure, the galaxy dynamics, star formation, yeah, and how also the planets form around a star. And what do these all give out, right? When you do all these simulations using computational astrophysics of all these different astrophysical processes and astrophysical systems or cosmological simulations, in the end, you're just trying to verify your model or verify your fundamental equations. And one such fundamental equations is nothing but general relativity, right? Which tells you how gravity works. So you want to test the gravity. You can also test special relativity. You can also test whether your Maxwell equations work out well. Because as I said, you need to input the magnetic field, and the way you input the magnetic field is actually by using Maxwell's equation. So you test all these, whether they actually work at such high energy limits. When the energies of these different big things become high, can you actually use those equations? Are they still valid? So those are the tests. And then constraining physics at high density, as I said. And yeah, and providing templates and data for observations. Like whenever you're trying to observe some system, what are you doing, right? Like supposing you take a compact binary and it is producing some gravitational wave, and you want to understand what is the compact binary, what is the individual masses of the black holes, what is the individual spins of the black holes, right? If you want to understand that, you need to have some data here so that you can compare it with the observational data. Compare these two and say, okay, since the observational data is matching this certain part of the results that I got out of the simulations, then I can say this is the mass and spin of the two black holes is. So you want to measure the parameters of your system. And to measure the parameters of your system, you need to have some results. And how do you get these results? In cases where you cannot have an analytical solution, is using computational astrophysics. So I wanted to show some cool simulations. So maybe I'll try to, okay. Sorry guys, this is not working. Yeah, sorry for that, this is not working. Sitara, do you want to try something else, or we'll just leave the videos?
No, I think we can maybe play towards the end if we have a little bit more time. So you can just continue with the talk.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, now, the next thing is gravitational waves and multi-messenger astrophysics. By multi-messenger astrophysics, what I actually mean is, when you have these two compact objects, right, which are revolving around each other, they actually produce some gravitational waves, right? And supposing if they have a magnetic field, they might also produce what are called FRBs, fast radio bursts, because of the interaction of these two magnetic fields. It may be, this is a possible model, but that may not be the perfect answer, but yeah. But when these two objects actually merge, they might actually produce a jet, okay? And due to this jet, supposing here is Earth, and you have a jet which is pointing towards the Earth, and here is the observer, then this is called a blazar. A blazar is nothing but an object which has a jet, and the jet pointed out to the Earth to the observer, and in this jet there might be some particles which are accelerated to high velocities, like protons and electrons, and these protons might actually react to the photons that are present in this jet to produce some neutrinos. There are some other particles too, but I'm not writing them out. But yeah, they might actually produce some neutrinos. So from this particular source, you not only get gravitational waves, but also you get radio waves. You get neutrinos. And you get... you also get a jet. A jet is nothing but it's seen in gamma ray spectrum. So you have gamma rays. You can also have X-rays due to this shock that are moving along the jet, which are actually accelerating these particles. And you can also have electromagnetic spectrum in UV, optical, and infrared. And these are mainly produced due to something called kilonova, which we'll come to later. So all this rich astrophysics is happening, and all, and multiple messengers are coming from a single systems. And in the end, you're tracing back all these multiple messengers to this system and trying to understand the astrophysics, right? And that is why it's called multi-messenger astrophysics. And this is what the new exciting field is, doing multi-messenger astrophysics, looking at the system through different ways and trying to understand how does this happen, like how do they produce these particles? Are there any current models which match the data that you collect through experiments, detectors, etc.? And coming to these gravitational multi-messenger astrophysics, one main way of doing is actually data analysis, wherein you're actually analyzing the data. As Sitara pointed out, you people will learn some data analysis. And yeah, in data analysis, the main areas of research are creating template banks. Template banks are nothing but a set of results that you get out of some simulations, which can actually be compared with actual data and infer the properties of the system. And that is what called template bank is. And in the case of gravitational wave, it's nothing but a bank of gravitational wave signals. And turns out to create these template banks, if you just rely only on computational astrophysics, it becomes really hard, because the computational astrophysics takes up a lot of resources, computational resources, and takes sometimes 11 to 15 days to simulate one particular system. So people have come up with more smart ways called surrogate modeling, which you can look up later. And one also want to detect some data, right? Like whenever you have an observed data, you have a signal and you have some noise, and you want to detect this signal. And how you detect this? By creating a detection pipeline. And what does detection pipeline come under? It comes under data analysis. And what does it need? It needs these template banks. And as I said, you also want to understand how those two initial stars actually, which are in a binary initially, come together, which are far apart, two regular stars, star one and star two, and give rise to two compact objects, which are close to each other. So how does this happen? How does this evolution happen? And how are these binaries distributed in our universe, right? So if you want to understand the distribution, how frequently do they happen? And once these two merge, does the remnant? So once these two neutron stars or whatever they form, right, they give rise to a single object, which can be a black hole or a neutron star. Does this black hole or a neutron star get a kick because of some anisotropy in the initial binary? And that is what called recoil. And one also wants to do tests of GR, and we want to see if some alternate theories of gravity can actually explain what you're observing. And turns out we don't really understand what's inside a neutron star is at the core, like a neutron star as a crust and a core. One doesn't understand what this core exactly is, because there is uncertainty in the equation of state. And what does equation of state is nothing. Like you can say it's a relation between mass and radius of your object. Like supposing I have a neutron star with a certain mass, it should have a particular radius, right? So it follows a certain curve. It turns out if you use different theory theories, you get different curves. And one doesn't know which exact curve to pick out. So there's uncertainty. And to figure out what is this exact curve, one needs to rely on observations. And yeah, and one wants to know how fast the universe is accelerating. So if one wants to know how fast the universe is moving, you want to know velocity is nothing but a times h naught, right? Where a is the distance, v is the velocity, and h is the Hubble constant. And based on the Hubble constant, your velocity of different objects, like you have different objects moving away from you. So it turns out you can constrain based on the gravitational waves what is the exact value of this Hubble constant is. Because currently there's a tension and nobody exactly knows what is the exact value of Hubble constant is. And one can also probe dark matter. I'll not go into that. So whenever you try to deal with this computational astrophysics applied to different systems, you usually take a system like two black holes or two neutron stars, which don't have any spin. They only have masses and they revolve around each other. And one of the reasons as to why we don't take spin is something different, like astrophysically. But unfortunately, we can't yet do a numerical relativity simulation wherein you can actually even capture the spin effects of these objects. So one wants to develop new methods which can actually try to deal with systems where there are spins, magnetic fields, and eccentricity in their orbits. And also, there might be some turbulence, some instabilities. Maybe I'll come to this slide later. Do we have any questions? Maybe I'm reaching the time limit. Okay, if you think I can carry on for a little while, like at least for 20 minutes, I can continue, else I can stop.
I think if everyone's okay with it, let's continue for maybe 15, 20 minutes. And what we can do is have another session just for everybody else's information. This is going to be an ongoing program anyway. So yeah, I think most of them would be fine with continuing. Maybe you can take questions later and just focus on the talk for now.
Exactly. Thank you. Okay, so then we'll split the talk and I'll talk the remaining part of the talk some other time. But yeah, then I can focus on these little minute things. Okay, so as I said, you can have two compact objects, right? Like hybrid compact objects. Like you can have a neutron star and a black hole. And we don't know how to simulate this system. We only know how to simulate a neutron star system or a black hole system. But one doesn't clearly know how to treat this system, or also this system, where you have one white dwarf and one neutron star, and how to treat this. So people like us, like you, who is interested in this, should come up with new methods and how to deal with this hybrid binaries, I call the mass, and how to evolve this so as to get the astrophysics out of it. And as you know, LIGO, every experiment has a noise curve, right? Beyond a certain limit, the noise in the detector becomes so huge that you cannot observe any things that happening below the noise curve. Like supposing you have a signal which is like this, and you have a noise which is something like this. So in using your detector, you can only observe those aspects of the signal which are above the noise curve. Below the noise curve, all those get absorbed into the noise, okay? So the type of noise that you have, it depends on the type of detector that you have, right? Where is it? What are the surrounding conditions, etc., like that. So currently, LIGO has a certain noise curve, but turns out when you go to LISA, which is the next level of interferometer, which can actually detect these gravitational waves, the noise curve actually goes way below. Instead of being somewhere here, it goes somewhere here. It means now one has to capture, model even these parts of the, the data, the result. Until now, uh, we are we were able to produce a certain data, accurate data, only to this till this level. Like supposing I give you, if I can give you a rough idea, like supposing this is the amplitude, okay? And the amplitude is ranging from 10 to the power minus 21. That's what the amplitude is, gravitational amplitude is. And if one wants to know if there is a gravitational signal, with time, it's h. Now the noise curve is somewhere around here. Okay. It means like it has a range, right? It goes from 10 to the power minus 21 to some 10 to the power minus 22. And now, since the noise curve is like this, you can ignore 10 to the power minus 22 because you can anyways not observing it because it is becoming part of the noise, right? So when you model your gravitational waveforms or whatever it is, your system, you can get accurate solutions up to 10 to the power minus 21, right? And some uncertainty in it, plus or minus some 10 to the power minus 21.5. But during LISA, the noise curve actually goes below this. It means your uncertainties in the numerical uncertainty, the numerical errors that you get while you're treating these objects can no longer be this. It should be smaller than this. Okay? It means you need high precision waveforms. It means you need to increase the accuracy of your waveforms and decrease the uncertainties in your numerical modeling. So how exactly one can increase the accuracy of your waveforms? One simple way of doing it is increasing the resolution. Turns out, as I said previously, you cannot keep on increasing resolution continuously because you have scarce computational resources. So one primary goal is actually to get high precision waveforms. And the next main thing is adding new microphysics into your system. As I said, there are a lot of neutrinos, gamma rays, etc., which are produced in the system, and one wants to understand how do these neutrinos interact with the matter around them. And imagine these densities are way higher. Like the densities are around 10 to the power 4 my 10 to the power 15 grams per cc centimeter cube. So since the density is very high, the neutrino cross-section, interaction cross-section becomes huge, and they can actually interact with the matter. And neutrinos do become important, and one has to understand how these neutrinos interact and they travel across the object in order to better model the system. So one needs to ask, add new microphysics, and that is what microphysics is. And one also wants to know, what if I use some alternate theory of gravity other than general theory of relativity? Can I get a different waveform? If I get a different waveform, is it more accurate? Can it more accurately explain the observation? Or general relativity in itself is accurate enough to explain the observations? So that's where alternate theories of gravity understand. And as I said, we don't really understand the inside of a neutron star. We want to understand how is the crust of it? If there is any superfluidity inside it, superconductivity is inside it, what is the inner core of this neutron star is. And I think I'll finally talk about this slide and stop with that and continue with another lecture later sometime. So comments on isolated neutron stars. So whenever I talked till now, I only talked about binaries, right? But neutron stars and black holes can also exist as isolated objects. And when they exist in isolated objects, some may actually be pulsars. Pulsars are nothing but rapidly rotating, okay-ish magnetic field around 10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 12 Gauss magnetic field. And the period of rotation is around some microseconds for pulsars. And if one can actually understand the inside of a neutron star, like the crust, the past, the inner core, the superfluidity and superconductivity, one can actually understand how do these light curve of the pulsar vary. Like how does the luminosity of the pulsar vary? How does the period of the pulsar vary? The period changes something like it decays with time, but it suddenly increases and it decays with time. Again, it suddenly increases. Why does this sudden increase and sudden decrease happens? Why does it decrease at all? So to understand all this accurately and model this accurately, one needs to understand the inside of a neutron star. And one can understand inside of a neutron star through models, right? that. So one can always get a better understanding of neutron star either using some binary systems or by observing individual systems like pulsars. And one famous phenomenon through which the pulsars are actually detailedly studied is called glitches. So a glitch is a phenomenon where the period of your pulsar suddenly increases for a certain amount of time. So this is called a glitch. Why does the glitch happen? And this glitch depends upon the spin of the pulsar and the mass of the pulsar. So by measuring the glitch, one can understand what is the mass and what is the rotation of this pulsar. And by understanding those two, one can trace back to what is the inside of a neutron star is. Because pulsars are nothing but rapidly rotating neutron stars. And that's where the glitches come in. I covered that. Superconductivity is also covered. Yeah. And cooling of neutron star. So whenever you lose a certain star, and since the empty the space around it is very cold, it loses heat through radiation, right? So the temperature inside of the neutron star keeps decreasing and energy is being released. So how does this neutron star cool down? So one wants to know that. And that is one aspect of area where people work a lot. And one wants to know what is the crust of neutron star and the atmosphere of neutron star is like, what is the composition of the atmosphere? Does it even have an atmosphere? If it has, what is the thickness of the atmosphere? So those are some questions. So basically, in this talk, what I wanted to say is these are the main open problems related to binary neutron star, binary black holes, hybrid binaries, and isolated neutron stars. And what other astrophysical happening phenomenon can actually happen with these compact binaries will come in that in the next lecture. Thank you for your time. I think I'll take questions now.
Yeah, I think there are some interesting questions in the chat box itself, so we can start by addressing that.
Okay. And yeah, people, it's not limited to this talk. You can always ping me up later too. So
I think it's a good idea if everyone on this session, just make sure you're on the discussion group. I'm just sending the link here because it's always better to have question and answers there as well. So you can get your doubts cleared.
Yeah. And as I said, I'm starting with Vishal99. So general relativity, you know what general relativity is, right? The Einstein field equations. And what magnetic field, they're nothing but your Maxwell fields. And what are hydrodynamics? Those are nothing but your three sets of equations called Euler equations, conservation of momentum, conservation of mass, and conservation of energy. So all these equations have some terms which are common in terms, common in both, right? Like maybe I'll show those equations next time, remind me. So I'll show those equations and you'll actually see that some terms which are in the general relativity are also present in the Maxwell and are also present in hydrodynamics. So all these are coupled nonlinear partial differential equations. Okay. And by magnetic field, I just mean Maxwell's electromagnetic theory. By hydrodynamics, I mean simple conservation of momentum, conservation of energy, conservation of mass. And by general relativity are nothing but Einstein field equations. Yeah, there are theories which actually propose that there can be a direct collapse to a supermassive black hole. But I should say, they still can't, so you see, there's a lot of playground here. Like you can play with your parameters and there are not a lot of constraints on how these constraints in the sense we don't have a lot of observational data from the early universe. And that is why there are a lot of models which can actually explain how these supermassive black holes form. And yeah, one cannot really say that this is the exact way how supermassive black holes form. There might be two, three ways how they form. Okay, that's a nice question. Unfortunately, we don't know. So there is this question asked, so there is Chandrasekhar limit, right? When a white dwarf actually goes beyond 1.4 solar mass, the star can no longer be supported. The white dwarf can no longer be supported with electron density pressure. And once it goes beyond 1.4 solar mass, we cannot even call it white dwarf. because vibrops are such compact stars which are supported by electron density pressure. But when the mass of the core reaches beyond 1.4 solar mass, which is the Chandrasekhar limit, the electron density pressure can no longer support the star and it collapses to a neutron star, right? So there is this distinct value of 1.4 solar mass when the object goes from Vipov to neutron star and it undergoes a core collapse supernova. But in the case of a neutron star going to a black hole, as of now, the numerical relativity simulations at least haven't shown any catastrophic things happening around the neutron star forming into a black hole, because you see, when a core collapse supernova is happening, the reason as to why there is so much of material that is getting ejected and there is so much amount of neutrinos that are being produced inside the core of a proto-neutron star and are released is because you don't have a horizon to stop all this. But in the case of a neutron star, even supposing if something like this is supposed to happen, it cannot go beyond the black hole. It'll, the event horizon will just stop it. So most of the times, the time scale for this shock to start from the core and go to the surface of the star and for the time scale for the horizon to form is actually very small compared to the time for the shock to start from the core to reach the surface. So most of the times you don't expect anything catastrophic to happen in the case when a neutron star collapses to a black hole. It's just a simple collapse where all the matter goes beyond the event horizon. And is there a specific value, a limit, mass limit beyond which a neutron star collapses to a black hole? I should say we don't yet know. And that is where all this thing called lower mass gap comes in. Like as of now, we know how to, we have observed objects up to a mass of 2.1 solar mass of neutron stars, but we haven't observed any objects which are between 2.1 solar mass and 5 solar mass. By that I mean compact objects, not regular stars, by compact objects. So people believe that there might be some physics that we don't know, which actually doesn't let any objects form in this mass gap. But now recently LIGO has started observing more and more objects in this mass gap, which is between 2 to 5 solar mass, and now believe there is no mass gap. But even now, either theoretically, computationally, or observationally, we don't have a particular value beyond which the neutron star collapses the black hole. And so why we don't have from theory point of view is because, as I said, we have a lot of uncertainty about the structure of the neutron star. By that I mean equation of state. See, just to give you a simple idea, by uncertainty and all that, what I actually mean is, so supposing you have a neutron star, right? So it needs to be stable. Like for something to be observable, it needs to be stable, right? If it's not stable, you cannot observe it in nature. So your star is stable how? It is stable because there's an hydrostatic equilibrium between what? Two pressures. Pressure due to gravity is equal to pressure to the radiation that is coming due to the nuclear fusion. But in the case of a neutron star, that balance is because between pressure due to gravity and pressure due to nuclear forces plus pressure due to neutron degeneracy pressure, okay? And one now wants to understand what is the structure of this neutron star is. By structure, I mean, how does the density change with respect to radius, right? So how does the pressure change with respect to radius? And that you get out by solving something called hydrostatic equilibrium, hydrostatic equations. Okay. And in the case of a neutron star, since gravity is strong, those are called general relativistic hydrostatic equations. So when you're solving these hydrostatic equations and one wants to understand if this can actually be achieved, we need to, these equations that you have, right? They're open, they're not closed. Meaning you have more variables than the number of equations, more number of variables than the equations. So in order to close this equation and make the number of variables equal to the number of equations so that you can get a solution out of it, one needs to input something called equation of state, where an equation of state is nothing but it relates your pressure and density. Okay, like how does the pressure change with respect to density? And as I said, as you go to these high nuclear density, high densities of around 10 to the power 15 grams per centimeter cube, we don't have any theory or any observations or any experiments on Earth which can actually explain what happens this high density. So you have something called quantum chromodynamics, which actually tries to tell you what this equation of state is. But turns out there are, this QCD is only valid at densities around nuclear saturation density, which is around 10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 10 grams per cc cube. But then how will you go from QCD from 10 to the power 10 to 10 to the power 15 and formulate a theory at these higher densities? Turns out there are different ways of doing it. So if you follow one path, you get a one curve. If you follow one more path, you get a different curve. You follow one more path, you get a different. So for each and every model, you get a different equation of state. The relation between pressure and density is what called equation of state. So you have multiple equations of state. It means you don't know for certainty whether this is going to happen and at what mass limit is going to happen, because there is an uncertainty in the equation of state. Until unless you solve, you put in the equation of state, you cannot solve these equations. Until unless you solve these equations, you will not know whether this can be achieved, right? So the uncertainty in this will not let you know what is the exact mass limit when the neutron star collapses to a black hole. So when I mentioned the black holes, I meant stellar mass black holes of a mass range around 10 solar mass to 30 solar mass, or maybe 100 solar mass too. And usually stellar mass black holes do not have an accretion disk around them. Okay, even if there were an accretion disk, it would have actually gone inside into the black hole. Because you see, supposing you take two black holes which are far apart and certain initially have some accretion disk, by the time they actually come close to each other and you can actually observe using LIGO, like here you can't observe using LIGO, we'll come to that later why we can't observe using LIGO, but yeah, once they are in the LIGO band, it's called LIGO band of frequencies, once it's in the LIGO band of frequencies and you can actually observe this compact binary, the accretion disks might have actually gone inside the black hole and you don't have any accretion disks. And even if they do have, people have analyzed and saw that the accretion disks have very little effect on the dynamics of the system. So yeah, but when you take supermassive black holes, you have huge disks and they cannot actually go beyond the horizon by the time they actually come close to each other. And there you do change in the dynamics of the two supermassive black holes, which have mass around 10 to the power 6 solar mass. There, the accretion disk can actually alter the dynamics. And there, we don't exactly know what happens to the accretion disk because no one till now has self-consistently simulated a supermassive binary black hole merger. Okay, so an elliptic galaxy is such a galaxy where actually all the hustle and bustle has actually stopped. A spiral galaxy is such a galaxy where there's accretion is actually happening. And that is why you actually mostly observe jets coming out of supermassive black holes at the center of spiral galaxy, but not elliptic galaxies. Yeah, he was asking, are there any observations, physical collisions between these giant stars? Okay, between compact objects, people have observed through gravitational waves, kilonova, short gamma ray bursts, etc., that I've been mentioning. But between giant regular stars, I don't know, to be frank, but that's an interesting question and I can look up and let you know. If two regular stars collide, what actually happens, and can you see any different electromagnetic signal, and can you differentiate between other electromagnetic sources? No, so electric fields do not induce magnetic fields. This question was asked again with this. These electric fields do not induce magnetic fields, but rather the currents which actually produce magnetic fields, because if you look at the Maxwell's equation and you look at the source of magnetic field, which is dou B by dou T, it's actually, if you look at the source terms on the right side, you see that it's actually electric currents. It's not the electric field which actually sources, because electric field is actually zero, because you have objects which are neutral. You don't have any overall charge. It's like you take a wire, you have a current in the wire, right? But when you ask me, is there any electric field? I'll say no, because the net charge of the wire is zero. But if there's a magnetic field, yes. Why? Because there is a current. Current is what's actually producing these magnetic fields. And yeah, people have observed magnetic fields through pulsars. Like the reason as to why these pulsars are actually decreasing in terms of the period is because of magnetic braking that comes from the huge magnetic field that's around the pulsars. Or you have these two jets, right, that are coming out from the poles, which actually called lighthouse. And this is also caused due to magnetic fields. So people did observe magnetic fields. But yeah, that's a good question that you pointed out, that whether these magnetic fields can actually produce electric fields again. So they do produce electric fields, but again, to produce electric fields, what happens? The charges need to be separated, right? There should be a new, it should be from a neutral system to a charges which are separated. But the time scale on which these charges will actually be separated and the object will be charged is very small. So even if the magnetic field actually does induce an electric field, it again automatically, the charges come together and then forms a neutral object. So we don't really observe electric fields in the astrophysical system. It's only the magnetic field that we observe. So the reasons for, Vishal asked me what are the reasons for noise. In the case of LIGO, the noise can be some car that is going around the LIGO observatory due to the earthquakes, or when you're trying to hang up these mirrors, right? This is a laser interferometry. So you have a light beam that's hitting the mirror. So you don't want the mirror to move a lot because of the pressure, the photon pressure from the light beam. So all these account for the noise. And we do have a good handle on the noise, but not to a very great level. But yeah, we experimental physicists are actually trying to improve and decrease the noise in the systems. And yeah, we can filter it. You model the noise curve and you remove the noise from the data and you get the signal. So data minus noise is nothing but signal. Sorry, I'm not a signal processing person. So I cannot answer this, whether we use analog signal for amplifying or digital. I'm not a signal processing person. There is nothing like crack in space-time fabric. It is a continuum. As of now, we don't know whether space-time is discrete or continuous. But now we work on an assumption that space-time is indeed continuous. If it were discrete, something might happen. But yeah, we don't yet know. So we don't know whether there is a crack in space-time. But as of now, our assumption is space-time is indeed continuous and smooth. That is the basic assumption of general theory of relativity, that the space-time is smooth. And that is why you want to cover your singularity beyond an event horizon, because singularity is a point in space-time where space-time itself is torn apart. What is a kilonova? Okay, I'll end with that, I guess. What's a kilonova is? So I wanted to show that kilonova thing too, but the videos are not seeming to play. Yeah, so what actually happens is when you have two neutron stars, right, which are coming close to each other and they're combining to produce something else, they actually, so when these two neutrons are coming together, they actually collide with each other. And due to this collision, some of the material gets ejected out, okay? And there are different other ways as to how this material can get ejected, but one simple way of looking at is when these two neutron stars actually collide with each other, due to the huge, immense shear forces, some of the materials get ejected out. Okay, and why are these called neutron stars? These are called neutron stars because all the matter that is present inside is neutron rich, meaning all the material. Like supposing you define something called an electron fraction, which is number of protons divided by number of protons plus number of neutrons. Supposing this ye is very small, supposing it's 0.1, it means number of neutrons are more than number of protons. It means your material has more number of neutrons compared to more number of protons. Okay, and when you have such a neutron-rich material, and this material that's getting ejected, so these two objects will actually combine together and form a single object, right? And around that, an accretion disk can form, or some outflows can actually form, where the material is actually just escaping the object because it has enough velocity to escape the gravitational field. So all this material that's present around here is very neutron rich, and it's not only neutron rich, but during this process there's also a lot of neutrinos which are being produced, there's a lot of neutron rich material, right? So supposing you take your crust, the crust has your regular atomic elements, like the ones which are present in your periodic table, okay? But as you go towards the center of the neutron star, you have more and more neutron-rich material. And as you go towards the core of the neutron star, you have free neutrons, free protons, and free electrons. Sorry, free neutrons, more and more free protons, and very less protons and electrons, because protons and electrons combine to give neutrons. So when these two neutrons actually collide and all this happens, all this material that gets ejected, right? Some of them will actually have these atomic nuclei, right? Which are coming from the crust. And some will have this neutron-rich, these neutrons-rich material, and some, and these these neutrons which are present inside the neutron stars actually come out. And once these neutrons actually get added to your regular elements, they give rise to another atomic element, which has a higher mass number. Mass number is nothing but number of protons plus number of neutrons, right? Where atomic number is nothing but either it's number of protons or number of neutrons. Number of protons, actually, yeah. So, mass number is number of neutrons, yeah, sorry. So, when a neutron actually gets added to your nuclei, it forms something called a radioactive nuclei. And since you are forming more and more nuclei which are neutron enriched, and so if you remember, there is a stability curve between the number of atomic number and the mass number. So mass number and atomic number. So there is a stability curve and a ratio between the number of neutrons and protons, and it should be around 2, as you may have read. Supposing if there is some element which is far from the stability value, and it has more number of protons than the neutrons, or more number of neutrons than the protons, they actually form what are called radioactive elements. And since they're not stable, and the ratio is not 2, which is called the magic number, they radioactively decay and come towards this stability valley, okay? And when this radioactive decay actually happens, they produce neutrinos plus gamma ray photons and some beta particles. Beta particles are nothing but electrons. And turns out these photons and the electrons which are produced in this radioactive decay heats up the accretion disk that's around this remnant object. This is called remnant object. And due to this heating, they produce, so what happens whenever you heat an object? It produces black body radiation, right? So there is some thermal radiation that's caused, and this thermal radiation is nothing but kilonova. Okay, so if you actually observe the kilonova, you can understand what is the composition of the disk, what is the mass of the disk, what is the velocity of the disk. So you can also constrain different models which predict this kilonova light curve. So one can also see if there are some signatures of some elements in these kilonova signatures. Like once you these neutrons interact with this atomic nuclei, right? They form higher and higher heavy elements, right? So you can look for the signatures of these heavy elements in the kilonova signatures. So just based on the kilonova light curve, which is nothing but a thermal radiation produced due to the radioactive decay of unstable nuclei to the stable nuclei, one can understand what are the different atomic elements that are formed in the accretion disk, and what is the mass of the disk, what is the velocities of the disk, what is the different proportions of the atomic elements that are formed. Like supposing lanthanides might form a lot, and actinides might actually form low. Like what proportion of the elements are lanthanides, what proportion of elements are actinides. So to understand all that, you need to model the kilonova. Okay, so understanding kilonova, one can actually understand all this, like how do elements greater than iron form in neutron star collisions, and constrain the models. So that is what kilonova light curve is, and that's all. That is all what you can learn from kilonova light curve. I guess there are no more questions. And if you have more questions, you can always ask me later. And I will go through the short gamma ray bursts, etc., in the next lecture. And also maybe show you some cool videos.